Thundergrunt.
Warning! The following program may contain adult or offensive language, excessive drinking, extra lives, heavy nostalgia, dragons, and general dipshittery. Listener discretion is advised.
You know we all die.
This is fun.
But the goal isn't to live forever, but to create something that will.
Two, three, four.
Here we go.
Infinite lives. We got infinite lives. Never say never. We're gonna live forever. Infinite lives. We got infinite lives. Never say never. We're gonna live forever.
Yo, heard you only live once. Well, I'm a disagree.
Holy shit. And welcome to MAGCast. I am your host, Big Adam, and my God, this is probably going to be released, hopefully, probably right around the same time that I released the last episode that we recorded.
But if you're listening to this, we released it, so
we did.
Congratulations.
You've done it.
I think Adam's just tricking us all into coming to hang out with him.
That also could be true. Anyway, I'm Big Adam, and I'm going to be the guy that says things. To my left is a man who has a basement. His name's Ryan.
That is in fact
that's
true.
The best one ever.
All right, this is how you know Adam's not even into it.
This guy's.
Although I guess it depends on how you define basement. Like, it's not actually underground, so I guess some would call it. It's the ground floor.
What now?
Oh, we're getting on the ground floor.
I refer to it as a basement, so you know it's all good.
Ground
but
floor. That's true.
Just for clarity's sake.
Sitting next to him is a lamp. And sitting next to the lamp is a man who lays down on 50% or more of our episodes.
I thought that he was referring to me as a lamp.
No.
I did too for a second. And then I looked at
the trying to figure out what he meant by that.
I love lamp.
And I was ready to be offended, but then he introduced me.
Yeah.
Hi, everyone.
The old lay down Orvy technique.
That's me. I lowered the mic to about 6 inches above the couch, and I am pretty much inside of the couch right now.
That's true. Sitting next to him is a chair behind a chair.
Is that me?
And then there's Huey.
Oh, hi. Huey. It's me. I'm Huey. And I am here, yes.
There's a chair behind a chair between you two.
Yeah. I like that we're introducing not only the hosts, but also my basement. Like, this is.
Well, the basement is now a character in the show, since we can never get our entire crew out here anymore.
It's true.
Just in case you're casing the joint via podcast.
Sitting next to Huey across the room, looking as delightful as ever, is the virtual drum kit.
Man,
and then
good
sitting
to see you again, buddy.
And
delightful.
Then sitting next to the drum kit is Mike, but Mike looks weird this time.
Oh, yeah. Hi guys. I'm angry about things. My name is
Mike.
Michael,
do you have
television.
Like an anti-cold or something? Your voice sounds really weird.
Yes, Michael.
Do you have a warm? Is that
my son gave me some sort of child sickness?
Are you warm? Are you?
And now I can't speak.
Child sicknesses.
And now Mike, I can't speak.
Mike is at home safing, and replacing him
that's
permanently
right.
is Annie.
It's
official.
I'm kidding.
It's unofficial.
Right. I am your rage nap.
There's some rules.
I'm the rage nap substitute.
We cannot replace Mike in any way, shape, or form. For he has created our.
Not unless
none
we all
of us
sign
have.
The Mike TV Accords.
Yeah.
Oh, God. Wait. What did you call him?
The Mike TV Accords.
Yeah.
Topical.
How do you feel about that, Huey?
I mean, honestly, look.
By the time this gets released, it'll be on DVD anyway. So.
People think are right.
By the time this gets released, that movie will be on DVD anyway, so it's fine.
I'm glad to see that it's on DVD. We've actually gone back in time to go forward in time to release it on DVD. It'll be on LaserDiscs. They still release
it. It'll be on LaserDiscs.
LaserDiscs. Yeah!
We've come full circle. That was an it. I was trying real hard to keep dicks out of the intro, and Huey just. Right
went
at the
right
end.
Just rammed it right
just
in, you know what
put
I'm saying?
It right on in the end. Jammed it in the end zone. Boom. Anyway, two MAGFest events coming up. I'm looking forward to both of them equally. And that's not true because I'm looking forward to one more, and I'll let you decide which one that is.
Oh, shit. Audience participation.
If you think you know which one Adam likes more, send us an email at
podcast@magfest.org.
I'd like to see the answers to that, actually. It'll be confusing.
Find out next time on MAGCast.
So the first one is June 17th through 19th, and that is MAGSTOCK 6.
Wow!
It's going to be awesome. This year is Resident Evil themed. Whoa. And we're going to have all kinds of fun stuff to
So MagStock has now been going as long as MagStock or MagFest was going when I first attended it. Because six was my first MagFest.
Yeah.
Whoa.
And now MagStock has been going that long.
That's crazy. Yeah.
MagFest in the woods.
I really hope that it doesn't grow
clearly long-lasting
like MagFest.
I don't think it really can at this because it's
there's
small,
a limited
much
amount
smaller.
Of space in that campground.
I just
now
hope
there's pretty much one less site.
Right.
Because the one we were in last year is not fit for
anymore.
Human residency.
Human
residency,
God.
Yeah. Nope, not at all.
I was like, human consent. Oh, no, that doesn't work.
No. Don't consume it either.
Definitely do not consume that campsite, whatever you do.
If you feel like consuming a campsite, please send us an email.
A podcast.
At magfest.org.
We'll direct you to the best one.
MagStock 6 will be held just like it always has been at the small country. I always want to say county. Small country campground in Louisa, Virginia, which is a forever drive away, but it's worth it when it doesn't put an Amazon River through your campsite.
Is it once again on the Father's Day weekend?
I think it's the weekend after.
Oh, nice.
Father! It's on the 17th through 19th.
Oh, I see.
So
that's exciting.
Without a U.S. national holiday calendar in front of me, I don't know.
If only one of us had a pocket computer.
I'm looking at dates on my phone.
So he still can't tell
I'm
us
looking
what
at
Father's Day is.
A list form of a calendar without being a calendar. Anyway, after that, July
June
30th.
June 19th is Father's Day.
Yeah, I was about to
so
say,
it
is in
Day
fact
weekend.
On Father's Day weekend.
Oh, fuck. My dad's going to be so disappointed in me.
July 30th is going
Whoa.
To be
What's new?
BitGen 11 here in Baltimore.
Wow.
It's going to be at Auto Bar, so it's going to be a kick-ass rock show. It's going to be a lot of fun.
Yeah, we're going back to Auto
going
Bar
back
this year.
To the old
That's
school
exciting.
Venue.
Yup. It's going to be great. It's likely going to sell out, so we should have tickets available here in a couple weeks.
It's a smaller venue for a more intimate show.
It is.
Ooh.
Do you have any
intimate encounters with MagFest
details for us, Adam?
Oh, yes.
Yeah, we were wondering.
We know so little
details.
About this show.
Give me those thick, sclusy juicies.
You've just been teasing us for like a month.
Juicy, sclusy.
Give me that sclusy fruit, bro.
Sclusy fruit. I feel like that should be a flavor at Rita's.
Oh,
sclusy
man.
Fruit?
That's
the
MagCast.
Official MagCast flavor, yeah.
You want some sclusy fruit?
Let's go talk to our new friend at Rita's. We learned all about the process of selling.
Oh, that's right.
It's
true. Yeah.
God,
oh, what happened?
Okay, we learned how they choose their flavors for the day.
How?
For the day?
For the day.
It goes by day?
It changes every day.
I did
what?
Not know that.
Like this one guy was like, guy walked up and he's like, can I get a watermelon? And he's like, sorry, there's no watermelon today. And I was like, so I walked over and I was like, how do you pick? And he said, it's whatever I buy at the Giant.
Are you serious?
Yeah, they just go to Giant
they just
and
buy
fruit.
It from Giant?
Oh, they buy fruit?
Yeah.
Oh, they make it on site?
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's just
really?
Like, it's whatever I feel like going to Giant. And
Rita's
getting...
actually just went up, in my opinion, because
so
they use
they
real
like...
fruit now. Yeah. I'm excited.
How do they make, like, Swedish fish?
It's just some blend of horrible fruit.
Or actual Swedish fish.
Or actual probably both.
They
just liquefy Swedish
throwing various things into this blender thing, and that's the end up. Try this new
I
mystery
had
flavor. Chalk.
Absolutely no idea that Rita's made their flavors on site.
Yeah, man.
I actually appreciate it.
So I'm really curious. So if you work at Rita's and want to tell us more about how they make their flavors, send us an email at
podcast@magfest.org.
I almost said send us a podcast at email at
magfest.fund. Yeah.
Please record a podcast on the subject and then send it to us.
Please record our next episode for us.
And then publish it, please, because that's the hard part.
That's definitely the hard part.
If you'd like to record our next episode instead of us, send them.
This time, I'm only going to take 99.8% of the blame, and 0.2% of that blame goes to Ryan for not uploading the episode to the Google Drive.
Well, I take my 0.2% and shift it to Google Drive for automatically uploading it when I put it
automatically
in my
uploading.
Well, no, I put it in the
my
Google Drive folder.
My computers did
it just
not do
sync.
My bidding.
Yeah, they didn't, jerks.
Well.
But yeah,
well.
No, it was my bad.
Well.
That's
but
exciting.
Anyway, I want to talk about some games that I've been playing.
Oh, really?
Oh, man.
Yeah.
What kind of games have you been playing?
I've been playing all sorts of games.
All sorts.
The first one, I got back
like
into Bloodborne.
Sorting games?
What?
Like sorting games?
Yeah.
Like the sorting hat?
I was sorting out nightmare worlds from real worlds in Bloodborne.
Whoa.
Yeah. That's not how that game functions at all. Nor is that even remotely close to the story.
Man, so Dark Souls 3 just came out and you're playing Bloodborne?
Yeah, because I won't let myself buy Dark Souls 3 until I beat Bloodborne.
But it's a different world, yo.
Yes, but it's basically the same game. There's, from what I understand, and
I'm
from
sure
what
the
I've
hardcore
seen,
fans would have much to say to you, sir.
There's so little story in the first two Dark Souls games, and in Blood, there's some story in Bloodborne, although it's not very clear on what exactly you're doing. You're just like, you're a hunter, and you've come from a faraway land, and this is all a nightmare, and everybody's dying. It's like, okay, well, why am I fighting all this stuff? And I have no idea to this point why I'm doing anything.
Because, that's so why.
It's just like, they were like, okay, we made this game hard as fuck, and we gotta have some kind of narrative element. Steve, you got until lunch to give me something.
Oh, man. That's a lot of pressure on Steve.
Greetings, adventurer.
Yeah,
they're
Steve
a bad
should get a
thing.
Raise.
Please kill them.
Steve at From Software deserves a raise for sure.
That's sure. a mouthful. Steve at From Software?
Well, it's called From Software.
So he's at From Software. God,
yeah. At From, yeah.
He's at From Software.
These goddamn video game publishers are out of control.
So, see, my favorite From Software is Armored Core. I was a big Armored
Core. Oh, man,
Armored
Core.
I also like Armored Core.
And,
it's pretty fun.
No, like, Armored Core 2, I played at, like, EB when PS2 hit. And, like, that was the game that made me want to get a PS2. I was like, wow, this is the best mech game I've ever played.
That was, like, two separate throwbacks to EB and the PS2.
Yeah, no, well, I had to think about it, because I was going to say GameStop, and I was like, it was definitely not a GameStop.
Was it called EB then, or was it called Electronics Boutique?
I think I'm not sure. I'm not sure when that transfer happened.
And then a lot of the Electronics Boutiques were old Babbage's.
Yeah.
I have never heard of
There's probably a store that like Babbage's? Was Babbage's, was EB, was GameStop.
Yeah, the GameStop
closed.
In White Marsh Mall has gone through all the phases.
Wow.
Video game store in Westminster Mall went through all the phases right up to and including going out of business. Yeah. So,
right.
did anybody else go to White Marsh Mall when they were a kid?
I never ventured to White Marsh until
there
I was
in
my 20s.
The original video game store in the mall was Babbage's, and it was really cool because it was the only store that I ever knew that had three. They had like a mall window display,
right?
But there was like a shelf thing that was all white, and it had like angled screens in it, and it was just three CRT TVs that were built into this thing, so you could just see the screen. And they used to demo video games on all three, and they were different games. And you just never saw shit like that, you know, in the early 90s, even the late 80s. You just never saw that. It was so cool. I love that story.
Do you just stand there and watch them?
When I was a kid, I would just go there and stand and watch those TVs. Oh, yeah.
Did your parents walk through the mall and be like, where is Adam? He's probably staring at a TV somewhere.
That's pretty much it. If I wasn't at the screen, I was inside the store.
Same thing we do now. We're just like, where is that? He's probably
staring at a TV screen.
But now we can all do it because we keep them in our pocket.
Yeah.
But, there's something really magical about those old video game stores that you really can't recapture because... Like there's just like the boxes and all like the going into these places was so
yeah.
Unique.
And the other thing that you'll never see again is, as far as I'm concerned, is half the store. It was a dividing line down the center, and the store was all PC.
PC,
and the others was divided along the systems.
You'll never see that again
games are all digital. I mean, you can get physical copies of PC games, but
why?
Remember back when you could resell PC games?
I bet 5% of PC games are physical media.
All right, here's a poll. Like, what would make you buy the physical PC game rather than downloading it?
Collector's editions.
That's the only reason I can think of anymore.
Yeah.
Yeah, but I feel like most collector's editions aren't even that exciting anymore.
Yeah,
like,
not
every
really.
Every so often there's a pretty cool one, but most.
It's like
it's
if the box
like,
looks cool at that point.
Well, so much, like, you're lucky. I feel like you're lucky if you get a collector's edition that has more than one non-digital item on it.
They're really cool.
Because most of them are like, here's a season pass, here's some bonus digital content, and, like, a map. Or, like, maybe a figure.
Yeah, for sure.
I mean, the only collector's editions I really buy that I can think of are, like, Blizzard ones. Because the Blizzard ones are usually solid.
I'll buy the Bees. I'll buy Blizzard, BioWare, or Bethesda.
Huh?
Yeah, the
Soldier 76.
It's a good system.
Yeah. It's easy to remember.
The Pip-Boy was worth it.
Pip-Boy was super worth it.
It's really cool.
Yeah, the Bees. Mm-hmm. You can't go wrong with the Bees. They always do something that's pretty cool.
So. I've never bought a Blizzard collector's edition, but I do own physical copies of most of my Blizzard media, but that's because of Ryan.
I've mostly given up on physical media. I've gotten rid of almost everything that like.
Now for my console games, I always buy physical.
I never buy physical console.
No, not and not like with my DS now. Like digital is the best thing that ever happened.
I 100% agree.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so I never buy.
I don't have to hold. Now I don't have to take around cartridges and all that. The only thing I buy on cartridge is like one of the Pokemon games for each generation. I'll get on cartridge so I can like switch it out and trade with myself and that sort of thing. Because you got to do that.
I don't play handheld gaming. It's not mobile gaming. I don't play handheld gaming as much as.
Yeah, I like that those are different. That's funny.
And it's I don't. It, and if I do, I'm playing one specific title.
Yeah.
And sure. I'm not swapping between games and stuff like that. But like for PS4, other than the PS Plus games, I have physical copies of everything. The only exception I have for that is Destiny.
Dude,
and that's because Huey bought me Destiny for my birthday a couple of years ago and bought it digitally. So,
dude, the
what a jerk.
Yeah, I know.
No, it's fine.
But I bought the Pip-Boy edition, and then I bought the digital edition of Fallout 4, and then I sold the physical edition that came with the Pip-Boy edition, so I just feel like I won that one.
Yeah, I don't know. I like having a physical collection, mainly because I'm a hoarder.
I've just gotten past that.
Yeah, like not even that. Just like having. I mean, I guess I haven't moved now in 5 years, but there was definitely a point where I was moving like every year, and like every time I moved, I was just like, I need less of this. And then I was sitting around. I guess it was last year. I think it was early last year that I just gave all my stuff and threw it into the MAGFest inventory. I was just like, yeah, this anything before like current gen stuff, I'm just like, nah, I'm never gonna actually like play that stuff again.
Yeah,
like
yeah.
Maybe I will, but I could also just do something else.
It all clicked for me like 4 years ago. I sold like 80% of my DVD collection. I was like, man, I'm never gonna use these, and I better sell them while they're worth something.
Yeah, well, that's the thing with having those big collections is that eventually they're just going to get outmoded anyways.
Yeah.
And then you're like, well, I could go watch this on DVD, or I could get it on Blu-ray for $10.
Or I get the digital edition and never have to do anything with
right.
worrying about scratching discs or any of that shit.
Oh, I feel man, like, you remember the scratching discs and you'd have to like skip entire scenes and you were so mad?
And then like you'd suddenly be like 40 minutes into the movie.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then you'd have to rewind the movie after you're done. Oh, wait.
I remember my friend's mom told him to rewind the DVDs. And he was like, have you ever rewound a CD, Mom? And she's like, no, I don't know how technology works.
Man.
At least she was aware.
Yeah. Yeah.
No, I don't get it. Leave me alone. I'm old.
All right, so, I mean, we have thoroughly gotten away from Bloodborne.
Oh, yeah. So I take it there's blood in this game?
Yeah, yeah. That game's fucking hard. I've also been playing a ton of Overwatch, because why the hell not? That game's phenomenal. Everything about that game's good. I haven't found something that I don't like about it yet. It's just awesome and wonderful. And then today I downloaded the beta that I've been in for a while but never actually played. I just sign up for betas whenever I see them. And Paragon for PC, for PS4, and I believe it's on Xbox One. I'm not 100% sure.
Yeah, nobody cares.
Anyway, it's right. it's either for PC, PS4, or the bookmark, or the doorstop, whatever you want to call it.
Wow, harsh.
It's...
We're drawing a line
horrible,
in the sand on that cast.
Horrible system. Anyway, Paragon's great. It's super pretty. For those who haven't seen it yet, it's a MOBA. Go shocking, I know. Done in third person. Done on the I believe it's in the Unreal Engine, but I'm not 100% sure. Yep. But the game's super gorgeous. Plays just like any other MOBA. The weapons buying system is a little weird. You have to pre-assign your character a deck, and your deck of cards are the items you can buy. So it's basically like the deck is a pre-built set for the character that you can go in and in turn level, like buy the items when you have the currency for them.
What if you want to switch your deck?
That makes entry a little bit easier, probably.
Yeah,
probably.
Yeah, it's an item in management thing. You can custom build decks, which is cool.
Sure.
But that's like you unlock the ability to custom build a deck.
Sure. Yeah, naturally.
Man, when you said decks, I thought I was picturing somebody like giving somebody like wood. It's just like, all right,
you
man, build your deck.
Build your
it's
deck.
It's like, what kind of game is this?
It's not the first time you've pictured somebody giving somebody wood, is it?
Probably not.
Wieners.
whoa, wieners and butts.
Anyway, yeah. But yeah, Paragon's pretty cool. Sign up for the beta. They're going to do open beta, I think, in late June, if I read correctly.
Sweet.
So that'll be good. It's a lot of fun. Video games are fun. I got Tabletop Racing World Edition, too, because that was free on PS Plus. That game's goofy fun. If you like arcade racers, that's a good one. If you have a PS4 and PS Plus, get that game. That shit's for free. They also got Tropico 5 right now, which I'll probably never play.
On PS4?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Weird. Okay.
Yeah, that's odd.
I don't know. It was free, so I downloaded.
Yeah, no, totally. No, I mean, yeah, download. That's not a game I ever thought I was being like, man, you know what I want to play this on? PlayStation.
Console.
Yeah.
That does seem odd.
Oh, well.
Whatever. It's a free game. That's
why
it's
for the free games.
Yeah.
So what games are you playing, Annie?
Annie!
I'm not.
I'm
kidding. I'm playing, through the newest Tomb Raider, but the one before that went on sale on Steam recently for like $4. And I was like, finally. And I got it. And it is actually harder than I was expecting, which is good. And I like the story a lot so far. I've not finished. But I'm having fun.
Well, that's good.
So that's the first of the reboot.
There's two. And this is the first one. But I definitely agree. Like, it's been said that they beat her up way too much at the very beginning. So you're like going through the game. You're like, okay, how is she not dead from that stomach wound inflicted? Like,
oh yeah, no, she
3 hours
like
ago.
I'm not even calling spoilers. That game's old. But yeah. So in the first like 10 minutes of the games, you fall and you've got a piece of rebar like through your stomach.
Holy shit!
And then she falls like 50 feet too. Like she clearly got head injury. Right, yeah. There's shit going down in this woman's life, and then she's fine. She just walks away, and then she kills some wolves, and it's crazy.
And then then you go through the rest of the game,
right,
which is no kinder to her.
Yeah.
So
she's Lara Croft though.
Of course, obviously, yes, but she's like teenager Lara Croft, and it's really weird. She's kind of whiny.
Yeah, but she's a strong, independent woman.
She's not yet. She's a strong, independent teenager.
That's fine.
Strong, independent teenager.
Aren't they all?
Ain't nobody holding her down.
No. Oh, and I just finished.
She don't need no man.
Finally finished.
Ain't nobody put Lara Croft in a corner.
No, that's true. You can't.
Not even wolves.
There are no corners on this island.
Oh, I see. This is round.
It's an insanely round island.
I also recently finished, the Telltale Wolf Among Us game, which is based on the Fables comic,
Fables,
which I'm a huge fan of, and I liked it an awful lot. It was a good prequel to the books, which...
Oh, it takes place before?
Yeah.
So it is actually canon in that world?
I mean, I don't know if it's like officially canon, but it could be. There's no reason it can't be at this point.
Huh.
They did introduce a bunch of different characters that were great. They have the Jersey Devil in it, which I was like, what? I've never heard of that before.
I'll have to see that.
Oh, you've never heard of the Jersey Devil?
I hadn't heard of it before it showed up, and then suddenly we watched that one Comic Book Men episode where the Jersey Devil was on, and I was like, oh, so this is like a New Jersey urban legend thing.
Yeah.
And they have him in the game. It was really good. But I highly recommend that one. It's pretty great. And it's one of those ones where I wasn't expecting this, but I'm really happy they did end every single episode on a cliffhanger. Or I don't know what you call them. Chapters, I guess?
Yeah. I mean, I think they call them episodes.
Yeah.
It's an episodic game.
Every single one ends on a cliffhanger, and it's super manageable. Like, if you only have, 30 minutes, and you're like, oh, I'll play a game, I recommend it.
Nice.
Get through an episode.
Cool.
What are you playing, Huey?
I play a lot of Destiny, and I play Hungry Shark World.
I've been
about Hungry Shark.
It's a great game, man.
That's cool. I'm glad you found
the replayability of Hungry Shark is
for those of
staggering.
You that haven't been following the show. Hungry Shark was our mobile game challenge probably a year and a half ago.
Yeah, at least.
And that was Hungry Shark Evolution.
That was one of the first ones we ever did.
It is.
Yeah.
Hungry Shark Evolution is that one. Now we've stepped it up. They've stepped it up. Ubisoft stepped in, and now it's Hungry Shark World. Three whole maps.
World.
Three maps. We were talking more sharks with a variety of different... Like, before, all the sharks were the same. They just changed size.
Right.
Now they have different abilities.
Oh, shit.
There's megamouth sharks.
Oh,
which
my God.
Are not... It's strange, because, like, there are non-violent sharks in this.
Can you play as a goblin shark?
Huh?
Can you play as
you
a goblin
can.
Shark?
There are non-violent sharks in this, but they turn them super violent. Like, a whale shark doesn't injure anybody, but this is, like... In this, it's one of the most deadly sharks.
Just because it's the biggest.
Just because it's the biggest.
Is it a non-violent shark, just a dolphin?
No.
No. They still have teeth.
A dolphin's a mammal.
Dolphins are also
they
hyper-violent.
Give birth.
Dolphins are pretty hyper-violent, actually.
Actually, wait. I think sharks give birth to live young, too.
Yeah, they do.
Yeah, it's weird.
They like they're the, those are the ones that like eat their brothers and sisters in the world.
That's right. They're fucked up, man.
It's really gross. That's
you don't
like,
want to be a shark, Adam.
The scientist who found that out, it was like some crazy story where he like was analyzing it and he had like stuck his hand in there and like pulled out like in the bait like embryonic shark had like tried to eat his hand and he had like a mangled hand.
My question to you is why do you like
yeah.
a shark?
Why would you stick your hand into a shark?
Biology. Get science. Off, man.
Huey, how do you like shark games so much when you're terrified of the ocean?
I'm not terrified of the ocean. No. Let's clarify.
I want to hear about this.
I don't ever want to go in a submarine. And I don't ever want to go into a trench. That's it. I'll swim in the ocean. I'll do things. But look, I'm fascinated by sharks. They're amazing. They're evolutionary pinnacles. All they do is eat and swim and make little sharks. And that's it.
They got the
so
best
they're all
wins.
Just hungry artists.
Yeah, man. They're hungry artists, and they've got so many paintbrushes. Dude, it's so cool, man. They're just like... And it's great. Like, somehow they overcome their need to eat everything in the whole fucking universe just long enough to fuck something, and hopefully they don't eat what they just fucked, because they might.
It happens.
They're crazy as shit. They're like... It's like Game of Thrones, but with sharks. And the three-dimensional environment.
You make it sound so exciting.
Yeah, sharks,
Game
man.
Game of Thrones? I haven't really watched Game of Thrones, but does Game of Thrones take place not in a three-dimensional environment?
Well, look, see, everything's three-dimensional, but when you're in the water, anything can attack you from any direction. So that's terrifying to me. And
so you wouldn't go in like a shallow depth submarine to look at coral reef and
I
stuff?
Would, I might do that. That's cool. But, you know.
Why trenches specifically?
Because they're full of shit that we don't. Look, man. There's
at
shit
the bottom
in the ocean.
Of the Marianas Trench, there's things that we don't know.
Yeah. I'm not dicking
that's
around
a fact.
With that. Or
that
any
is
trench.
An absolute fact.
I'm not dick. And also, I'm paralyzingly terrified of fucking. Look, if all of the people I loved were right behind a giant squid and they needed me to somehow just get near it. To save them, they'd all be dead.
A giant squid.
I'd be like, sorry, guys, total hard reset on my life. I'm out.
Hard reset. That's pretty fucking funny.
Yeah, man. Like,
giant squids.
Yeah, squids, they're the man. Ones. They're smart. They pump out ammonia to stay floating, so they smell like shit. Their eyeballs are like beach balls. They have long fucking things. They have hooks in their tentacles, so when they grab you, they grab you, grab it.
They swim fast as shit.
Yeah.
They're like little missiles.
They're little missiles. They're the worst things. And they're orange. That's the worst, right?
What?
So what? The ginger? Wait a minute. The worst?
I'm just saying, man. They're horrible.
Oh, God.
Humboldt squid will like pull your arm out of your socket. They're like 6 feet long. And like, there's this like, I've watched all these goddamn
documentaries.
So like
giant squids where they find whales that have suction marks all the way around their bodies.
Yeah.
That's like, that's
yeah,
nightmare fuel.
That's fucked. who wants to see that? I mean, I do, but not anywhere near it. I want to see it in the safety of this little pocket computer I have and be like, oh, that's pretty fucked up. That's my life. As far
they,
as
they
it comes
thought
to
for a very, very long time until I'd say in the last 5 or 6 years that they were a myth. They didn't think they existed.
They look,
no,
man.
they found one, but yeah, I think it was more than 5 years ago.
Look, there's two different kinds of squid. I don't want to get into this. This is a goddamn video game podcast, but I'll go into it. There are two kinds of squid that are fucked up. There's the Alcatoothus ducks, which is the giant squid. It's like 45 feet long with its fucking tentacles. That's like a bus. I'm not fucking with a bus. A fucking ocean bus with a beak. What kind of a loving God makes beak? Tentacle creatures. Oh my god. Anyway, moving on. There's also, I don't know what the fucking like scientific name is, but the colossal squid, which looks stupid. It's got a big ass head and like tiny little grabby finger things. Tentacles, that's it. And its head is, they've only seen one of each. And the one that they found, they're hauling it aboard and it's just like, when you pull it out, it's like
just
a fucked up jello mold with fucking teeth in it. It's got hooks and shit, man. Go watch the movie The Beast. All right?
Pass. This is what, Huey, you can't
it's like
watch
Jaws
scary movies anymore.
With fucking a squid. And the squid, like, fucking bites a dude's leg in half. And that's the sound of the tentacles whipping around.
So, would you play a giant squid hunting video game?
I have. I played the Jaws video game, and there's a part where you have to fight a giant squid in an underwater drilling facility, and you have to bite off all of its tentacles, and then it's just like sitting there like, well, fuck, and then you bite its whole body up because your jaws.
Wait, in this game, like, oh, you're the shark.
Yeah, you play the shark.
You're not just a dude, like, biting off people.
It was so great. That game is so good. Everybody go play Jaws for PS3, I think it was, or maybe 2. It was great. Although there is one really sad mission where you have to eat a dog, and I was not okay with that.
What about a horror Squid game?
What are you doing?
You're in the ocean in a personal submarine by yourself with no lights.
He's trying to get into your psyche.
In a personal submarine with no legs?
Lights.
Why would I ever do that?
It's a video game. Sounds you don't like have a choice.
A VR game?
I have plenty
it's
of choices.
It's a VR game.
Oh, man.
No, there is lights, but there's like it's like three LED lights on the outside that it's just like one tiny little LED, so you can just see shadows.
But
so
you only have you only have enough power to power one at a time.
So why am I doing this? What's the point of this game?
You're looking for some kind of amazing treasure that'll make
fail.
You
fail. No,
just person to
there's no treasure
existed.
In the universe that I will I will cross paths with a goddamn squid. They're messed up. They're messed up, man.
What about little squids?
All squids are fucked. Although cuttlefish are cute.
Will you eat calamari?
Yeah, man. You got to eat the enemy. You got to let them know. They need to know that I'm number one. They're smart. They remember shit like elephants. They're like the underwater fucking Freddy Kruegers of the universe. They're fucked, man.
What do you feel about? Underwater, how do you feel about octopus?
Freddy Krueger.
Octopi are cute. Although
they're
it's not octopuses.
Cute. It's octopodes.
Whatever. Fucking octopins. I like that one. Octopins.
Octopins.
So, because they have eight little pins, you know? Because that's, you know, no. Like the 50s term. They got pins. Their legs. Legs are pins. God damn it. Anyway, octogams. There we go. they're cool, man. They're smart. They can open doors and shit. I mean, I don't want to fucks with one, but I got respect for them. They're not nearly as big. They're not nearly as strong.
Are squid strong?
Squid are fucking make. They pull the dude's arm out of his socket.
In a movie?
No. God damn it. Why are we talking about squid on this podcast? Anyway, there's an episode of this show called Monster Quest. And I've seen every episode. Yeah, it's true.
Good job, Huey.
And the second episode is about the giant squid in the Sea of Cortez. I will never go to the Sea of Cortez because it's full of fucked up weird ass squid. That change color and they flicker and they flash and they tell each other things with their colors and then they all and they come at you. And there was this fucking fisherman jamming his arm in the water because he's dumb. He should fucking move. And this fucking squid pops out of the water and is like, hey, bitch! And grabs his arm and starts yanking it and pulls it out of its socket. And he's like, fuck, there's a squid that's got my arm. And I don't remember what happened. But
it rips his arm off?
I don't remember that much of the story. I probably tweaked it out. Probably, who knows? Maybe it wanted another arm. I don't know. Squid, greedy.
That squid has 17 arms now?
Yeah, they fucking keep what you kill. It's like it's like Riddick rules. Anyway, the long story short, don't go to the Sea of Cortez. And TLDR... Don't go to the Sea of Cortez, and if you ever see a squid, shoot it.
Dude, you are so stressed out right now.
I'm really tired, and you brought up the thing that I will sacrifice everyone in this room for. So, yeah, man.
Jesus.
This might be the best tangent we've ever gone on in this show.
That got real as hell.
So yeah. That's what I've been playing. Hungry Shark. I was trying
to remember how we got on that. You're right.
I've never seen you in this state.
Oh, God, man. You think I'm playing? I will leave you all to die horribly if it came down. Man. If there's a villain out there who's like, how will I tear this team apart? You bring squids into the equation. Jesus Christ. So now, man, video games have really changed my life.
Oh, fuck. Jesus.
I think you broke Adam.
Anyway. What are you playing, Orby? Any goddamn terrorizing fears?
I don't know how to follow that up.
Speaking of tentacles.
Oh, great. Man,
speaking of tentacles, how about them old gods,
oh,
Ryan?
Oh, my God.
Yeah. They're old and godly.
C'Thun has arrived in the realm of Hearthstone.
Yeah. He's here, big time.
So Old Gods released, I've of course been playing Hearthstone. It's the thing that I do. And in addition to the new expansion releasing, they introduced a new mode, which is standard mode, as opposed to their wild mode, which is like everything. And standard, like similar to like Magic and other fast-moving trading card games, it only allows the most recent sets to be played. So all of the stuff that Ryan, myself, and other Hearthstoners have learned to hate over the past year or so, a large majority of it has been phased out. So all of the Curse of Naxxramas cards, mm-hmm. all of the
Goblins versus Gnomes,
Blackrock
Mountain still
active,
and League of Explorers is still active.
Right. So it's honestly the most exciting Hearthstone's been since like
probably launch.
Yeah, since launch, totally. Because like so many of the cards from those two sets were like the staple auto includes for every deck. Right?
Yeah.
You know,
Piloted Shredder,
Sludge Belchies,
those two were enough.
Even all the Naxxramas stuff, like the Spiderlings, Lotheb, like all that stuff was huge, and now it's no longer a thing. You know, the Nerubian Eggs.
Yep.
Yobot. And then Dr. Boom, and I just...
Oh, man,
just
Dr. Boom, yeah.
So much stuff in those sets was just everywhere. So now there's new stuff, and all the old stuff's gone, so decks are just wacky, and who knows... Like, it's exciting playing, and, like, when things start happening, like, halfway through the game, I'm like, I don't know what this guy's planning.
Right.
I'm going to try to play around what I think might be going on, as opposed to, like, all right, I know, like, three turns in, it's like, okay, I know this guy's whole deck.
Yeah.
You know? So,
I mean, give it a month, and I'll probably get back to there. But
oh, yeah, I mean, the Hearthstone moves fast because the saturation is so huge, and there's so many people, you know, it's always, like, the second or third most viewed game on Twitch and everything, so everyone's copying whatever the streamers are playing, copying whatever decks they find on the net, and then, like, you know, it'll get honed down to, like, the top five decks or whatever, but
right
now it's still pretty wacky. Yeah. People are still trying to figure out how to use C'Thun well. Like, there haven't been any major events for us to, like, really see some high-level play with those cards.
Yeah, and I love how many of the cards just, like, in the new set have...
Kind of like end game conditions.
Yeah, and it's just like they've got such like crazy effects that aren't like just dumb. They're really exciting, I guess, kind of game changing effects that, you know, you play, like, even if you lose because somebody played one of these cards, it's still a really cool event.
I
mean, it sucks if you lost to it, but, like, you know, if you lose to a crazy Yogg-Saron, it's like that blew, but, like, man, was that entertaining to watch.
Yeah, so, like, for instance, the idea of the set is like the old, like, so C'Thun is like this Cthulhu kinda dark creature, and, like, it's actually corrupted most of the other things in the game, so, like, there's new versions of a lot of characters, so,
oh, that's
like,
cool.
There's, you know, Ragnaros used to do 8 damage to a random character, now it heals 8 damage to a random character, you know, there's a new version of Hogger, etc., that are all corrupted, and then, in addition to that, there are about, what,
there's
four?
Three other old gods. There's four total old gods, one of which is C'Thun.
So there's three other old gods, and there's a new Deathwing, too, that's really cool.
Yeah.
He's effectively a god. I mean, but, so each of them has kind of like an endgame condition. C'Thun, the big one, has about a dozen other cards that all buff him in some way when you play them.
So, so does it, like, all those, like, variations on the existing cards, is that, like, just when that one god is in play?
They're actually new cards, but, like, their shtick is that they're a different version. Like, they're unique cards.
Oh.
So, like, if you bought a booster pack, you know, you could get the corrupted whatever. And it's
an
entirely new card, but the kit is the same. So a lot of times it'd be, like, similar stats or, like, the same effect, but, like, different stats.
Yeah, just applied differently. Yeah. So it was fun to see that. And then it was also, like... Like we said, the old gods are all tend to be like endgame conditions. So one is like the god, you know, the corruptor that reborns everything that died with the death rattle effect this game. So the idea is you like want to have all these really powerful cards that have effects when they die. And then you want to set up a board position where you can drop that, fill the board back up with all these crazy creatures and close out the game. C'Thun, for instance, like we were saying, gets buffed and buffed and buffed, and then comes out as like a 20-plus stat creature that also deals that much damage to everything on the board. It's nuts.
Yogg-Saron's the super crazy one.
Yeah, so Yogg-Saron is the most fun. So for every spell you have cast that game, when you play him, he casts a random spell on a random target. So if you've played 23
spells,
that's
alarming.
You play him 23 spells from the entire game, completely random, go off on completely random targets, and it's just insane.
That's really
sometimes
awesome.
It's really funny. Sometimes it'll just kill whoever played him. Sometimes it's
great.
More often than not, that's I see Yogg-Saron die to his spells before he before his madness has completed.
Yeah, but it keeps going. If,
oh yeah,
dying,
yeah, no,
it keeps
going.
Wow.
Yeah.
No, I remember like watching the reveal stream. They were like, I think they were revealing pretty much all the rest of the cards, and they were doing some show matches. I don't know if you watched that at all, but like the end of it, okay, the end of it, like the guy who was streaming, he had Yogg-Saron in his hand, and he also had like he had lethal, and he also had Yogg, and he was like, do you go for the win or do you go for the glory? And so
you gotta go for the glory.
Especially on the set reveal stream, you have to play that, but like. It was spectacular.
What does the animation look like? Is it just like a bunch of spells?
Oh, no.
It just pops up each of the spells and then like throws it at the target, just as if it'd been played from somebody else. It's really,
that
really interesting.
That sounds pretty funny.
What else did we see
in the set?
Yeah, what's the other guy we're missing?
Oh,
one
man.
More.
Oh, there's one that summons
clearly not a cool one.
A random, I think, 10 cost minion from your deck. Or no,
it puts
10 cost minion in your hand.
Yeah. No, it puts it on it puts it on the field.
Oh, on the field, you're right.
Yeah. Yeah,
no, it's a random, any random minion from your deck. Sorry, I'm thinking of something else.
Yeah, there's the 10 cost beckoner.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, then the last guy just like he comes out and at the end of every turn, he just pulls something onto the field from your deck
for free, regardless of the cost. So.
Yeah. So that's that can be pretty devastating.
Yeah.
But yeah, he's not as much of like building up to that. Like he's something you can just kind of slam down and
I feel like good things could happen.
You
could deck drain yourself really quickly with that.
Yeah, fatigue doesn't often come into Hearthstone. Like it's definitely a thing. Like you get two control-y decks, like warrior or priest, that are going against each other, and it gets into those super late turns where you're taking damage. Because in Hearthstone, you don't just lose if you run out of deck, but every time you draw, you take a damage, and each time you draw after that is additional. So you take one, you take two, you take three, you take four.
Oh, man. Wow.
So it gets big damage pretty quick once it gets into fatigue. So, like, it's funny on those on those long games where both players are trying to calculate it, like, all right, how many turns can I last? How long can I drain him? Like, it's funny. Hmm. But, yeah, there's tons of really cool effects. And more I've been seeing them with, like, especially C'Thun and specifically, where they keep doing effects that they're really taking advantage of the digital medium, like because it's a lot of stuff that just couldn't happen in card games, like if you're playing with physical card games, which is good because I like playing physical card games, but I'm enjoying Hearthstone more because it does things that you can't do in physical card games.
Right.
Cool.
So, but yeah, Hearthstone's happening. What else?
Diablo season started a week or two ago.
Oh, yeah.
That's been kind of fun.
Yeah. I haven't played that, but Dawn of War 3 just got announced, so I'm super psyched for that.
Oh, nice.
Dawn of War 2 is my game. And I played Hyperlight Drifter, which was really awesome.
I want to play that.
Have you not played that?
I've not yet.
I don't even know anything about it.
Oh,
so
man,
cool.
It's really cool. It's a three-quarter view game. It's an action-y, not really platformy, but action-y, puzzle-y. And all the combat's really tight. So you only generally have like, I don't know, like 3 or 4 HP. Mm-hmm. And you're like dashing around, like hitting people, dodging attacks. Like the combat's punishing, but it's like tight. It's good. It's a lot of fun. And like, you know, you're going through, unlocking stuff. It's kind of Zelda-y and yeah, I don't know.
Like, I really love the art.
The art style is like really cool. Like it's all
it's
like
kind of retro 80s, right?
Oh yeah, it's definitely like retro pixel graphics, but it's that kind of really nice look, like Sword and Sorcery.
Exactly.
Kind of. No.
Yeah, totally. Just a little more colorful than that game, but
say,
still like that quality of like pixel art.
Very pretty.
Yeah,
and that music is really great. I actually bought the soundtrack.
Yeah, that's I was
before.
Mad at Huey. I was like, you bought the soundtrack and you haven't played the game. Come on, man.
I mean, I really like the trailer.
But yeah, Hyperlight Drifter was really cool. And there's one other thing I bought recently that I haven't played much. Battlefleet Gothic, which is the 40K in space game, which is pretty cool. It's just it's just spaceship combat, like RTS style. It's a lot of fun. You get ships and commanders and cool abilities and blow up other ships. It's good.
That's nice. Fun. Can you be the Tau?
You can't be the Tau.
All these games suck.
Oh, Huey just really wants space cows.
Yeah. Space cows are cool. They've got like Robotech stuff. Yeah, I know. So do the Eldar.
Did you just moo at me?
Yeah, I did.
Ryan, what have you been playing?
Let's see. I've been playing some Hearthstone. I've been playing some Diablo. The new season's been fun so far. I mean, it's not a lot of major like content changes. Just kind of new season, new excuse to play Diablo for a while. That's always good. I think that's what we're doing for video games. There's one interesting board game we've been playing at work that's been kind of fun. It's called Warhammer Quest. So essentially, it's a two to four player cooperative board game. I guess theoretically you play with one player too. It's a cooperative board/card game where essentially like each of you kind of has a character and you're playing through these series of missions. It's like a hybrid of like a board game and D&D. So it's like a mini D&D campaign almost. Huh. So essentially, like, you start off, you each have four abilities. And you kind of go through these missions where you're fighting specific enemies, which are like on cards, and you go through these rooms and explore them. And after each mission, you can like upgrade an ability and you get loot that carries over to the future missions. But it's like a 5 or 6 mission campaign. But it's been a lot of fun. It's like, it
really
scratches a lot of that D&D kind of itch in a much simpler, less, it doesn't require nearly as much effort to put in or like, you know, years of right. time. And they both totally are different experiences, but it's kind of been fun to check that out.
Nice.
Other than that, I think those have been the big ones.
Yeah. What else has been going on? Nothing?
Nothing?
It's a short episode.
Squid make ink too.
I think we have some mail, don't we?
That's fucked up.
We had that, though, the one email that came in. I wasn't going to read it because it's way outdated, but.
I mean, so's our show.
It just said that the
about
debate.
About 43 episodes past its prime.
It just said the debate continues, and it was a link to a Kotaku article about ranking series.
Oh yeah, we don't read Kotaku articles here on MAGCast. Sorry, whoever that was. Try harder next time.
Do your own dirty work. Yeah, it was all about different cereal rankings and stuff, and they had some stuff in the God tier, which was ridiculous. They had s'mores cereal in God tier.
No, incorrect.
Get the fuck
garbage.
That's ridiculous. Somebody bought that gimmick way too hard. Apparently,
yeah,
that's a gimmick cereal. That doesn't have longevity at all.
No, not at all.
It does make me wonder, though, if like someone at Kotaku was watching the Serial World Finals panel at MAGFest, and they were just like, oh, man.
I should put my own list together.
Yeah.
People thought that was funny. We could be funny. We're Kotaku. You know what's really funny?
Kotaku?
We could be
ours
funny.
Was democratic.
We're Kotaku. you know what's really funny?
That's their motto.
For a really long time, MAGFest was completely blacklisted from Kotaku.
Really?
Yeah.
Why?
So, going into MAGFest 4, it was either 4 or 5, somebody, and I won't name names, called the minions of MAGFest on Facebook and was like, Kotaku's not covering us. You should email them and tell them to cover MAGFest as like a fan request. And after the 700 or 800th email that Kotaku got, they contacted MAGFest and said, please tell your fans to stop messaging us. We've got the message. And then they refused to cover us until MAGFest 10. And the only reason they picked us
they
up
had to.
Was because they had to because
we were
Uematsu
awesome.
Was in town.
Oh,
Jesus.
And even then, they only
we
mentioned...
We forced their hand. That's the only reason we invited them, to stick it up Kotaku's butt.
they only mentioned MAGFest, like, twice in, like, 9 articles.
Wow.
They were, like, at a popular video game event in the Washington, D.C. area.
So there's no...
That's petty at that point.
So there's no real reason? They just were, like...
They were real pissed that a bunch of our people on command sent them emails and flooded their inbox with requests to cover MAGFest. So then they just didn't for years.
Do they now? I don't even know.
They do now.
I think so. Yeah.
Wow.
They did the Uematsu coverage and they got a lot of
good
positive
pictures.
Responses from.
They got a lot of
now,
hits.
Now they do like
or
just mentioned
or
they
hearts
do
or whatever they got.
They do cosplay articles. They do guest articles.
Yeah,
they do
all,
band
all
articles.
All their usual con coverage.
Cosplay.
That's Orvi's world, man. I was going to get into cosplay. I considered it for like a week.
I'm doing it.
He's
I'm
Destiny,
going for it.
You're
I don't
do a
know
Destiny
about
character?
Dude,
I am.
You should
you know, just
I'm
for
Titan
the, just
armor.
For
I'm
the record.
I'm Bella Titan.
That would be cool as shit.
Because I don't have to look like anything.
Right, exactly.
you don't have to look exactly
I
like
I do, Orvi.
Look, okay, Bucky. Easy, killer.
You don't have to look exactly
it's
like...
It's not my fault you look exactly like the actor.
That's only even a costume I've worn like to 2 events.
False.
No.
You have worn Bucky to at least 10 things.
All right.
I don't know about 10, but more
than
3.
Yeah, I don't even got the damn shit together by the, like, the week before Mac. I actually have an aversion to the term cosplay.
Really?
Just for the record. Because when I started costuming, cosplay was specifically a term used by the anime folk.
That's
true. And all the 501st and myself and, like, the Rebel, all the Star Wars and sci-fi folk... and you know, Ghostbusters, everything else. We were just costumers, and cosplay was very much. And you can hear it in the fucking name. It's just an annoying, like, cosplay.
Yeah, you know. All right, let's come up with a new term right here.
If you ever notice, I when I'm referring to myself, I'm always saying I was costuming or I was in costume.
Well, you should.
I'm
okay,
a costumer.
How about
costumer?
You're not into costume play. You're into
costume
business.
You
get that looked
at if you got a costumer.
Cosbiz?
Cosbiz?
That sounds like Cosby.
No, that sounds... Yeah, that's got a negative.
We gotta stay away from
that. All right, maybe cause is entirely something we should avoid.
We could be the Cosmooks, which is, of course, shortened to Cosmos.
Well, that's just us.
Battle dressing.
Battle dressing?
What if you're a pacifist? As a peaceful person.
Yeah.
Yeah, what if you... What if your costume is a pacifist?
Oh, no.
Pass play.
God, that sounds like something you do with your Nintendo DS.
Yeah.
Time for pass play. Yeah.
But yeah, no, I always refer to myself as a costumer, not a cosplayer, just because I'm a... Because
it's serious for you? It's not playing?
No, just because I associate it with annoying anime children.
Aww. I prefer the term cosplayer.
Holla.
Huey, yeah, you're on the task for coming up with
costume.
A new... You don't have to do it on the spot. I'm just
costumed
saying.
Individual.
I mean, you're going to have plenty of time to thinking about it while you're working on your Titan armor. So
yeah.
What style of Titan armor are you?
I'm thinking about going with the best one.
Okay.
I don't know what it is. There's so many fucking armors. I haven't really.
Which exotic are you going to put on?
I was actually thinking about going with the glass house just because it looks
really?
So cool. Like just because
it
looks awesome.
Be hard to make.
Yeah, man.
He's going.
Did you hear anything from those peeps?
I haven't talked to anyone yet. I didn't even know we were going to be here recording.
I'm
this
super
early.
Serial.
You can ask Annie. I did not want to come out here.
No, he was
yeah, I mean,
bad.
I didn't want. I was literally asleep.
I happened to wake up to let the dog out.
And then I see we're still trying to wrangle Huey. And I was like, oh, fuck. Let me get out of bed. So I got out of bed and I put on these clothings and I came here.
And here
I was in the dead of sleep.
He was having nightmares
about
squids.
That's my whole life.
I sleep, giant squid nightmare.
I see squid. I don't understand hentai. Fucking come on, man. Jamming tentacles into women? You don't want tentacles anywhere near you. They got hooks. They got hooks, people. Goddamn fucking, what's wrong with you, Japan?
Of all the things.
It's just like, man, come on. We don't have to jam everything into women. There are some things that are not okay. Let's just... Yes, all squid.
Wait, yes, all squid comes out of that?
Yeah, because we don't... All squid are terrible. Like, you just have to think about it.
Oh, yes, all squid are terrible.
Yeah, yeah. I just cut it off.
That's a different connotation of that hashtag entirely.
Well, yes, all... I mean, look, I'm also not for, you know, the sexual exploitation of squid. They don't know what they're doing. They're not cognizant. Of that,
so despite your,
I thought
hatred
you said they
them,
were so
not,
smart.
They're smart in like, hey, I know that face. They're not smart like, man, I'm being sexually molested right now. All right,
or used as a device to sexually molest.
Yeah, you just don't jam living animals into people.
I think that's a motto we can all live.
Yeah, by. Fucking hamsters, leave them alone. Hamsters should not be in people's asses. I'm just drawing a line.
All right, Adam, we better cut this off before this gets any worse.
Look, it's in South Park. There's a whole episode with Mr. Lenny Wings.
That must be true.
Yeah, people, you know, they stick animals in other people.
Isn't that gerbils?
A gerbil and a hamster. They're like fucking two sides of the same coin.
Is there a gerbil dance
smaller
album somewhere?
Than the other.
Like...
Yeah, I mean, a dwarf hamster's pretty teeny. But I still wouldn't want to jam it in me. I don't understand. Keep animals out of your goddamn rectum. And your vagina. And your mouth. I mean, actually, your mouth is the one place animals belong when they're dead. Stop eating live animals. That's a terrible way to go.
Wow. This episode has just been real.
Look, guys.
Animal rights here.
Hold on, this
here.
Is... This
I'm not...
Is the
animals...
This is the Huey corner. I'm going to put that Full House really high-pitched sound that they always played in the music when Danny Tanner's giving sound advice to his daughters.
This is not sound advice. This is obvious advice. This is not like, well, look, Michelle, sometimes when people make fun of you, you have to stand up for yourself. This is like you're jamming live animals into your rectums and vaginal canals. I get canal. I guess it's a sea creature.
Oh, my God.
I don't know, man. This is going
Adam,
on a dark
cut this
path.
Off.
I have been
cut
awake for so long today. It's Mother's Day. Happy Mother's Day, Mom. Sorry about all the squid shit.
And I think with that, we're going to close this episode. Which one is this? 44?
Who knows?
My God. Episode 44 has come to a close. Thanks a ton for listening. Much appreciated. My name's Adam.
I'm Ryan.
We're over here.
Huey and Squid Suck.
I'm Michael Television. Good night.
Thanks for listening. See ya.
Go watch The Beast.
The views and opinions expressed in this podcast are those of the hosts, guests, and artists featured on the show. They are not necessarily the views or opinions of MAGFest itself. Any questions, comments, or complaints can be sent to podcast@magfest.org.